Welcome back, and to start with our first segment for today, talking about the World Tourism Day, a very special day that we celebrate here in Egypt. And this time we are celebrating by eliminating the facade, actually, of a Karnak temple in Luxor. We're going to discuss this in more details with our guest for today, Mr. Said Taha. He's a tour guide, actually, and he has a lot to tell us about this beautiful place and this important event. So first of all, let's shed the light on the choice of this site to celebrate the World Tourism Day.
Yeah, actually, Luxor is very, very important historical site and the archaeological site. Let us say that you can follow the history from the Middle Kingdom up to Greek-Roman time in Luxor. And we have a variety of artifacts and historical sites, like those big temples that we can see on the east bank of Luxor city, the complex of Karnak, and the other one, Luxor. Actually, nearby Luxor city, there are other two temples. One is called El Tud, and the other one is called Midamud. It's not common in the... It is not common in the touristic programs. Always we are talking about Karnak and Luxor. And also, within maximum month, they are going to open the ram-headed avenue or the Sphinx avenue. This is very, very good and will be a good celebration there. And they are going to realize back that journey taking place by Amun or Amun when he leaves his house, Karnak Temple, to visit his harem or his consort house, Luxor Temple. Actually, it was called in hieroglyphics Ebit Isut, that means the residence of Amun or Amun. And the other one is called Ebit Resit, the residence of his consort, goddess Mut. It's called Mut. The ancient mentality, they couldn't imagine the life of gods different from the life of the human being. According to their mythology and their religion, there is a male god with a female goddess and a male son. That's why we always talk about Atarayad, or three deities. Amun, his wife is Mut, and his son is called Khonsu. That's very common everywhere you go in Egypt, where it is a historical site. You will find this holy Atarayad. Like here in in Memphis or in Saqqara, we are talking about Tah or Ptah. His consort is called Sekhmet, and his son is called Nefertum, and so on. They chose this point to be, or this historical site, because it's a renowned place. And the difference between the, the facade age and the sanctuary age, about 2,000 years. Let's say that the temple originated during the Middle Kingdom, talking about 2000 BCE. And the facade itself dated back to 400 BCE. The temple started at the time of one of the kings. His name is Sosistris, or we call him Sonosert. And nowadays there is a place in Karnak Temple, we call it the Open Museum. There are lots of stones, blocks of stones, waiting to be reassembled again. They reassembled a place, we call it the White Chapel. This white chapel dated back to Sosistris or Sonwesaret, one of the kings of the 12th dynasty, about 2000 BCE. That's why we say maybe Karnak Temple was originated at that time, and then was enlarged by the kings, especially those kings of the 18th and 19th, 20th dynasty, and also those who followed them during the 21st dynasty up to the end of the ancient Egyptian history. One of the kings, his name is Nakhtnebef or Nektanebus, the one who held erecting or the construction of the facade dated back to his time. But unfortunately, the facade was left unfinished. That's why when you go to Karnak Temple, you will find one tower of the facades higher than the other one. And also when you pass the main entrance of Karnak, behind the facade you will find some ruins of mud brick. Those are the walls which composed what we call it the ramp that they used to raise the stone or to lift the stone up for the building. That's why this place was chosen, because it's very important place, especially in the ancient Egyptian cult or the ancient Egyptian religion. When they going to celebrate the opening of the Sphinx or the Ram-headed avenue, it's a part of this avenue, it's in the Sphinx statues, and the other part in Ram-headed statues. The ram was related to Amun-Ra, the official deity or the official god in this area. And the Sphinx, it's a kind of depiction to show the strength of the king, and in the same time he got a human mentality. And this dated back to the time of not only the common idea that the first Sphinx, that one in Giza. No, we have an oldest one dated back to the time of Djedefra. Djedefra, who came to the power after Cheops and before Khafrin, that we relate the Sphinx to him. Even there are a lot of stories saying that the Sphinx is old than the mainstream history that we are. Well, it's a kind of, theories taking place by some astronomers and some geologists. Depending on those vertical grooves that you can see in the shaft or that place where the Sphinx being built in or being cut in the rock in. This vertical grooves, the geologist is American geologist saying that may be caused by falls of water. And that was, he's saying, that was dated back to the time of rains. The rains age, and the rains age, you're talking about 8,000 years BCE. So it's, they are trying to say that. And they are trying to say that this Giza Sphinx is was all a lion, I mean a body of a lion and the head of a lion as well. And then the ancient Egyptian came and they found it, as I said, a completely lion. And they carved the head and they changed it from a lion head into a human head. And he, depending on the proportion, because the proportion between the size of the head with the body, it doesn't match. The head is very small comparing to the body. It's a topic, a side topic, but it came, very interesting to be discussing. Regarding this, even it's not related
but
with the topic.
But for sure they did it on purpose. What I mean is that when we talk about Egyptian history and these temples and these monuments, you will find that everything is done or built according to a certain measure, and they are taking certain calculations.
Yeah.
So let me ask you about the festivities taking place this year. How do you see it, especially that we are starting the winter season, and definitely these locations or destinations are preferable during winter time?
Yeah. Last Sunday I was in the Museum of Civilization guiding a Spanish group, and they came, and that was a, we call it optional tour, it wasn't in the program. So they asked for this museum, especially after they saw the Golden Parade in the TV, and they said, we want to see the mummies. I said, I will see, because the program is full. If there is a time, I will add this in the program. It will be like kind of optional tour. And they insist, we can, instead of say staying in the National Museum 3 hours, we need to be there just have an hour and a half and whatever. We need to
So thanks
find
to the propaganda of the social media and definitely the media.
So that gives you an example how is the media and how is advertising is very important to, a kind of promotion for the tourism. And especially when some stay in a place and then he go back to his country or his...
The word of mouth.
Exactly, exactly. This is very, very, very important because it's very truth. It's a truth advertising because it's experience. The one who experienced that, he go back to and talk with his friends and his family, so they encourage them to not only the Civilization Museum, we are talking about many museums being opened recently, especially the one in Sharm el Sheikh and in Sohag as well, very important museum, also in Kafr el Sheikh and Sohag, in my opinion, needs to be advertised more because that one related or close to that famous temple, Abydos temple, and this Abydos temple is related with Osiris. Osiris is very important, let's say it's a kind of main deity in ancient Egyptian cult and ancient Egyptian religion.
Talking about all these events taking place again to start or getting ready for the winter season, and talking also about the opening of the new ram road or route over there. As you mentioned, of course, talking about all these things have an important impact on anyone who's going to receive the information or to hear about it, as you mentioned. How can we use this more and more to attract more tourism or talking about the flow of tourism to this area?
I want to give you a hint exclusive to this program that within a week or 10 days, we will reveal a new discovery in Saqqara. And this discovery is held on by Dr. Zahi Hawass. He is looking for the tomb of Imhotep. That will be very, very, very important when we find the tomb of this high architect. And he was a physician doctor as well. Actually, Imhotep, in the last years of the ancient Egyptian history, during the 26th dynasty,
I think he was
dynasty,
the only architect to be dealt with just as a king or as a pharaoh, due to all...
As a deity.
Yes.
He became as a deity.
And he has many jobs and many titles, actually.
He was, you know, of course, the title scribe. This is very important because if you know how to read and write hieroglyphics or the Egyptian language, that means you will get a high position.
Vizier, yes.
Yeah, you can compare this with in Europe in Middle Ages. Those who knew how to write and read Latin language, they will definitely get a high rank or high position. That was the same idea in Egyptian time. Actually, if we find this tomb, will be
a great hit.
A great, very great. And I think you can compare it with the gem. With the gem, exactly. Because it's very important because Imhotep, there is a city in, or a historical site in Italy. It's called Pompeii. That city was covered by lava. And when they discovered this city, they found a chapel dedicated to Imhotep as a deity, not as a scribe or as an architect. And also they found a chapel there for Isis. This is very important because that means they became cosmopolitan, their cult being known in Rome at that time. All these events that's going on will help a lot to advertise the tourism. And thanks to that program, nowadays it's there is a program in the Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities under the supervision of that lady, Ghada Chalabi. She is a very active lady. And now they hired a very known company in the advertising, and they started already. Now you can find small videos talking about each province in the, even those are for the locals, but the same, the other side in different languages for the internationals as well, you can find it in other channels. I mean the renowned channels or TV channels, and especially to, you know, for the new generation in the social media. Social media is very, very important, and with the passing of time, it comes very essential and very main matter, especially in advertising. Due to the circumstances of COVID-19, so everybody is using nowadays social media. So and it's not that expensive as you can do advertising on TV channels. I think that with the passing of time will become like the main source of incoming tourism. And I don't mean that the travel agency will lose their work, no. But well, through those media,
but social how can media you know about a place? Definitely by just searching and looking for different places. And whenever you find someone who's sharing, for example, his experience in Egypt, or talking about the services that were provided for him, for example, all these things matter. Definitely, again, in tourism in particular, word of mouth is essential.
It is essential. That's why we invited the Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities invited some bloggers in Sharm el Sheikh, I think a couple of months ago, and they did a good advertising for Egypt, especially each one of them. He had like 3-4 million of followers, and that will add value to advertising the tourism in general. And this is very important.
You know, talking about history and civilization, I believe that whenever time will pass, or regardless of anything, it will remain forever attracting people.
Yeah.
Yes, we have many people who prefer to go to the beach, prefer to enjoy the sunny weather, but when it comes to discoveries, ancient Egyptians, pharaohs, temples, of course the Grand Egyptian Museum, everyone is anxious to find out more about it and wants to take this trip as well. Especially now that we have the choice. It is very close. If you want to go to Luxor, still you have the chance to take a couple of days, for example, in Hurghada, and you will be back to continue your historical tour.
That's why now we have a lot of tourism coming from Russia. And they stay in Sharm el Sheikh or Hurghada. They do a one-day trip to Cairo to visit the National Museum in Tahrir Square, and then to
and
the
pyramids.
And
thanks, of course, to all mega projects that took place for the infrastructure, because now you are linking the whole country together. You can go wherever you want. It's not going to take long. It is
actually
safe as well.
This is very, very important, what was done, paving the roads and the bridges everywhere where you go. Those helped a lot to save time during the visit. This is very, very good what is going on, arranging the infrastructure, and will help a lot and will add value to tourism as well. Because some people are asking, why we have a lot of roads and a lot of... You will see this in the future, will help a lot. And not only in tourism, of course, in commercial sides and all that.
But of course it helped even in tourism. I mean, for example, in the transportation in particular, sometimes people are staying in the hotel and they want to move on, for example, to visit the Giza pyramids, moving back to the National Museum, moving back to another place. If they were following the traditional old routes, you can never reach anything in one day. But now, you can move around the country. Just I want to recall, I want you to remember this.
In old days when we've been working in this field as a tour guide, and we suffered a lot.
It was hectic
as well, and we lost a lot of time in traffic. And now it's very... I'll give you an example. The day before yesterday, I was in Alexandria. And my guests sit in a hotel nearby here where we are. And when we came back from Alexandria, I told the driver, there is a new road you can take it. That's the Road Al Farag Bridge. And that saved at least an hour and a half. An hour and a half when we came from Alexandria, 2 hours up till this bridge, and then we took the bridge. It took like only 25 minutes. And it's before Sphinx Airport. Of course, there is out stop. You have to be a ticket, but it doesn't matter. That saves fuel, and saves everything. Time is very important.
And the scenery around you, of course, this is also used to be very, very important after all the developments that took place. If I'm talking back about the Giza Pyramids Plateau, for example, this area now has changed a lot.
A lot. I was there recently, and now the tourists can enjoy easily walking around the pyramid and walking from the first to the second pyramid. Before that, there was a lot of, you know, those people who sell things and those who ride their camels and their chariots. Some of them, not all of them, because some of them are, they knew what is the importance of tourism, and some of them, they are a bit, you know, tough with the tourists. I can't neglect that. That's why organizing all this.
Now we have a special area for those who are interested to go into the bazaar or all this, or to take a drink, for example.
And they are going to arrange electric buses taking you from the main entrance of what will be close to Fayum area. And those electric buses will take you touring the whole area.
All these are essential services, actually, to attract more tourism to all these areas. And let me also ask you about the initiative that was launched talking about the winter season in Egypt. Come to Egypt to enjoy a winter vacation.
So. Nowadays, we receive tourists from United States. From Spain, there are
actually, just allow me, I've met many people coming to Egypt from the United States recently. I met them in the Giza Pyramids Plateau, in the Egyptian Museum, in some of other museums in here in Cairo, and actually it didn't happen again before.
There are three renowned travel agencies. They resumed their work. It's not the same volume as it used to be before the COVID. Let's say about two-thirds of percentage of that they had before. I have some colleagues who work with those travel agencies, and my renowned colleague Walid Al-Battuti, he was guiding, I met him in Luxor, and he was guiding four owners of the travel, five actually, three from United States and two from Beirut. The head office of the those five travel agencies.
Let me say those who are coming from the United States, actually it is a very long trip, not as those who are coming taking 4 hours from different countries in Europe, for example. So.
And when I was in Alexandria the day before yesterday, I met some tourists who came in those boats who are doing the Mediterranean cruise. Some of them, they get off from the boat just to visit Alexandria, and some of them, they get a bit earlier to visit Cairo, one-day trip. We call it a quick trip from Alexandria to Cairo. They start at 5:30, 6 in the morning, and they finish roughly time 10, half past 10 evening or at 11 at the evening. So the boat is stationary for 12 hours in the dock, in the port there. And then they give them the chance to go down to visit the historical sites in Egypt. Those who visited pyramids before, they visit Alexandria and vice versa. Those Mediterranean boats, we used to have a lot of tourists. Sometimes we get like 50 buses in the quick day trip from Alexandria to Egypt. That will resume again and again. And also, we started to receive charter flights from Spain. On Saturday, the charter flight come from Spain to Luxor, and in Monday as well, the two charter flights.
Right, at the end, Mr. Said Taha, tour guide, thank you very much for joining
us. Thank you for having me.
Right, and still we have more to bring you on our breakfast show. But first, moving on to a quick break, then we'll be back with more on our show.